America in the late 50s, a land in the grip of communist paranoia.
But the bullseye of the enemy's target is you, your family, your home.
Whilst the government was busy preparing the nation for war, a new music had swept the land. Rock and roll owed much to the old hillbilly and blues tunes that had been at the heart of the 20s Southern recording boom. It also picked up on the boom's commercial drive and had been taken to the heart of the nation's teenagers. 16 coaches long. But in 1958, Uncle Sam took Elvis away, leaving the coast clear for a strange new sound. Tom Dooley was an old song that dealt with such unsavory subjects as murder, hanging, and venereal disease. In the hands of the Kingston Trio, it would shift 6 million copies and start a youthful craze for something that looked like folk music.
When the sun rises tomorrow, Tom Dooley must hang. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley, hang down your head and cry. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley, poor boy, you're bound to die. I met her on the mountain, there I took her life.
Show business is a business, and if you pay me to do what you want to call me, that's fine. I'll be whatever you want to call me. And that's what Capitol did. They called us folk singers and built that whole thing up about it. We didn't say no, we didn't say yes.
Hang down your head, Tom Dooley, poor boy, you're bound to die.
It was a continuation of wretched pop music in a folk music format.
Where I'll be.
But they were playing guitars, so it was new novel. And mom and dad could hear it, and the kids could hear it.
I was a fan of the Kingston Trio. I can actually remember the first time I heard Hang Down Your Head, Tom Dooley. And I didn't know it was folk music.
I always say, the Kingston Trio were like the Beatles to us, you know, in the earlier days, because they were a group that they were so exciting, and they made it so much fun that everybody wanted to do that, you know. And so many kids went out and bought banjos and guitars because they wanted to make that kind of music.
In the wake of the Kingston Trio, a host of preppy emulators would emerge with names like the Limelighters, the Brothers Four, and the Tarriers. Their shiny, clean-cut sound was the perfect soundtrack to 50s suburban America.
The beginning of the folk boom as a major sort of phenomenon, I think, was very much part of the suburbanization. I think the idea of the suburbs was that everybody was moving out of the cities and back into the countryside, only it wasn't the real countryside. It was sort of a cleaned up, friendly countryside. And that's exactly what the folk boom was producing.
The folk boom was huge, but it wasn't the only folk music around. Back in the 1940s, an urban revival of old Southern music had emerged in New York. It was a tiny movement, spearheaded by Woody Guthrie and Pete Seeger, and centered on the common beliefs of the active left. Despite its size, the revival had achieved some commercial success before the communist witch hunts of the early 50s snuffed out further potential. But as the folk boom arrived, the revivalists saw a chance to poke their heads above the parapet. Alan Lomax, back after a decade of being blacklisted, was in the thick of it.
Well, you're in Greenwich Village now, where people come to get away from America. It's not jazz around here anymore. It's folk music. Jazz is hi-hat and aging. The young people have gone mad over ballads and blues, guitar playing and banjo picking. We're recording here tonight. We're having a party, so come on in.
Back in the late 50s and the early 60s, there was this thing called the Folk Revival. Newport Folk Festival was big, and there was lots of record companies forming, and it was the revival.
The instruments are played by young people like the New Lost City Ramblers, Mike Seeger, electronics engineer, Tom Paley, professor of mathematics, and John Cohen, a photographer. But those boys really know how to play mountain music.
We were opposed to so much of what was being passed off. We were the enemies of the folk revival. If we succeeded with our point of view, then it would have to go. The Kingston Trio or the Lime Ladders and all that would have no place in the world that we were thinking of.
What we wanted to do was to play the songs that were played by urban people in pop style or classical style. We wanted to play it as close as we could to the original traditional style, sometimes with our own take on it.
I mean, so the Kingston Trio and the Brothers Four and the Weavers all earned a lot more than what we earned. But we were earning something and doing music that we loved. And then we were also successful in influencing a lot of other people who got interested in playing this kind of music, so that we were one of the roots of the later folk revival.
I've spent my time writing books about American folk music, but this new generation have gone straight to the source.
In 1960, the new generation of purists would produce the revival's biggest star.
Joan Baez was a shy young woman who was very serious about what she did. She had purposefully gone with a small record label who she signed with specifically because they'd been the main label hiring people who'd been blacklisted. And she was also a very beautiful young woman with an extraordinary voice.
Mary, how you call that?
What appealed to me was the ballad. And people would say, well, why do you sing these long, sad ballads? And I didn't even understand that I was sad. You know, I was a neurotic kid, basically, and in that way, it suffered a considerable amount. And these songs spoke directly to my heart.
Some call him Jesus, think I'll call him Savior. Ooh, I think I'll call him Savior. Ooh, I think I'll call him Savior. Glory be to the King.
When Time magazine did their article on folk music and put Joan Baez on the cover, she really became sort of the person, the one face and the one figure that was associated with that, and she was a good one.
I knew it was folk, what I was doing, and I knew I was folk, and that was what made sense to me.
Glory be to the
The songs felt not the weight of history, maybe the lightness of history. I mean, they took me back to something, and I brought them maybe to the 60s, something like that.
Glory be to the King.
Now that the music had a youthful star, it really took off in all its forms. In New York, youth descended in droves on Washington Square Park, keen to have a go.
There was something very universal about that Washington Square gathering. it was wonderful to be in this same room with Armin.